Welcome to the 10 o'clock worship service. We are still going to have... are we going to have another one? No, later. We will end our series on Missio Dei. Part 6, what does it take for ichthus to be missional? And so, week number 1, we talked about the theology of Missio Dei. Missio, mission, Dei is God. The mission of God, there is only one mission. God's mission, and we are simply joining Him in His mission. The second week, we talk about living in a community because God is a community, the three persons in one. And so we also live in a community. In the third week, we talk about being saved. And for as long as you say you are a Christian, you have been saved, you are, remember, you are saved to be sent, okay? Everyone is sent. And then we talk about missional living. And then practical missional living, the natural rhythm. Today, let me end it. So the question is, what is next for us? Let me give you a quote. Here rests a promising generation who never realized its potential because they busied themselves with many good things, and these are not the bad things, at the expense of their one thing. So all kinds of distractions today, all kinds of entertainment, and taking away our time to focus on the most important. And some people do not have a clue, an idea at all, what life is all about. For them, they eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow, we diet again. That's what they say. For them, life is circular. You start something in the morning, you end something in the evening, and goes around the next day. And somebody called it meaningless. No other but Solomon. Let me read what he wrote. He was getting older. You don't have to open your Bible. In chapter 1 of Ecclesiastes, he said meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do you mean? Meaningless when you have everything. What do people gain from all their labors as which they toil under the sun? I mean, what's the purpose of working ourselves to death, earning so much money? As far as Solomon is concerned, it's meaningless. Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. How true. The sun rises and the sun sets, and then hurries back to where it rises again. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. Condensation, evaporation, and all of these. The same thing. The same thing. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. Now he's getting tired. The eye never has enough of seeing. We say sa Ilonggo, nibabusog ang mata. You want more and more and more. Nor the ear, its fill of hearing. Marites, marites, marites. Verse 9, what has been will be again, and what has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Same thing. Is there anything on which one can say, look, there is something new. It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. And verse 11, listen to Solomon. He said, no one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who followed them doubt true. When we die, people will remember us for how long? They might visit us every day. But after several time, 1 year, 2 years, who cares? They don't remember us anymore. They won't remember you. You won't remember them. Maybe for several years you would, but the time is going to come. They won't remember. They couldn't care. And then Solomon says, wow, what is life after all? How true. We need to understand what life is all about. If you don't understand what life is all about, three things can happen to you. Number one, you can waste it. In your notes, you can waste it. And there are plenty of things that we can waste our lives. We can waste it on non-essential things. And before we know it, you're getting old. And before you know it, who knows? We're going to die. And Solomon says, life is meaningless. When you live a life without a purpose, when you live a life that without a goal and no focus, you are just using up space and time. Therefore, Solomon says, life is meaningless. You can't only waste it, but you can spend it. Yeah, you can spend it on your career. You can spend it on your hobby. You can spend it on your possessions, believing that these things will matter or these things will last forever. No, they will only last for a while. And if you have built everything all for yourself, you are in for a great disappointment. They will not last. The third way that you can spend your life, you can invest it. Say with me, invest it. Why should I invest my life? Really? Why not waste it? Why not spend it? I can do anything with my life. But as a child of God, remember this. You have to invest your life. You know why? Because somebody, the greatest investor of all time, invested his life in you. God invested his life in you. And not only that, he wants you to accomplish many things in life, and he gave you the Holy Spirit so that you can do what he commanded you to do. And when you obey what he wanted you to do, you get purpose. You have meaning in life. So there you go. Jesus invested in you, and he knew where to invest. He invested not only his life, but his resources in you. We are going to talk about that. Therefore, what Jesus is saying, I have invested in you. What are we going to do? We need to invest our lives, same thing. Invest in what? Invest it back to him, because it's guaranteed an ROI. But when you invest your life in the world, there is no ROI. You only invest your life back to the Lord where he guarantees a return of investment. A hundredfold. That's why we will talk about rewards. And that's the reason why Jesus told the story about the parable of the talents and many other stories in the Bible. You cannot imagine Jesus talked about money, material things, whatever, 8 times more than faith. Why? I mean, why would Jesus do that? He talks about money more often. He is not there to give you and me financial advices. You know what he wants? He wants you and me to see ourselves. He wants you and me to see who we are. He wants us to know what we value the most. You see, the measuring cup of our spiritual life is also based on what we value. You cannot serve both God and mammon. You can't. Somebody has to give up. And so let's look at the story here. It is called the parable of the talents. And I know you heard this story when you were still in grade school, but let me again repeat it to you. Matthew chapter 25, 14 to 30. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one, he gave 5 bags of gold, to another, 2 bags, and to another, 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with the 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. Wow. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. You come and share your master's happiness. Now listen, verse 24. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was so afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put your money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be, wow, taken away from them. And throw those worthless servants outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. 7 very simple principles, but very, very important. If you learn all of these and apply these, it will make a major change in your life. Believe me. Very simple. Very, very simple. Number 1, ownership. Everybody knows this. Everybody. Say with me, everything I have belongs to God. See that? You know that. Everything belongs to the Lord. In this story, very clear, the owner simply entrusted his property to his servants. It did not belong to the servant. It belonged to the owner. And he was going away, and he's coming back. So very clear, we own nothing. We own nothing. We did not come into this world with a certificate that this belongs to me, that this belongs to me. Nope. Everything belongs to the Lord. So, what you have, what I have, we simply get to use it for how long? 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years, and then it's gone. So, we are simply here entrusted with God's resources, simply to manage it, to be good stewards. Again, whose property was it? The master's. We don't own anything. God owns everything. Now watch this. I know that we know this. This is a very simple principle. But once in a while, we have a tendency to forget, believing that we also own everything. Therefore, what happened? It changes everything. It changes your behavior. When you start believing that you own everything, what do we say? Because I own everything, I can do whatever I want. It's mine. Ako niya. Pag gusto lang kuya. No. It doesn't belong to you. It was only entrusted to you. You see that? It makes a difference. Everything belongs to the Lord, including your life. So we only get to use it for how long? I don't know. 80, 90, God willing, 100 years. Simple principle. But if we don't really internalize this, it can change the way we handle resources. Number two, allocation. Wow. Allocation. God has given me some talents. Verse 15. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, to another 1, each according to his ability. Well, each one has his own. During the days of Jesus, a talent was not just a currency. It could also mean a weight in silver, which means about 15 years of wages. Can you imagine? That's expensive. So what's the point here? The point here was that whatever that was entrusted to them was really expensive and precious. And it's not a small matter. It was a big deal. You can't imagine this much was entrusted to the servants. So for you and me, God's life, God's resources entrusted to me and to you. So it is not a small matter. If you don't internalize this, again, your tendency is, it's okay, pag gusto lang kuya. This is my life. I can do anything with my life. Wrong. No. God gave you resources. God gave you talents. Could be in the form of abilities, resources, opportunities, everything that was given to you. And when he has invested in you, he wants a return of his investment. Have you ever thought about that? Let me share with you God's capital. You know, God is a great investor. And he decided to give us all of this capital. He gave us financial capital, money, that's the currency. He gave us intellectual capital, that's the concept, ideas, you know. Even how you decorate these flowers comes from God. He gave us spiritual capital, the wisdom that comes from God. Wisdom is different from knowledge. Knowledge is what you have, but how you use your knowledge is wisdom. And that is from the Lord. You see, sometimes you meet people who are full of knowledge but no wisdom. Have you met people like that? Masiling ka do kaalam nga do hindi man kaalam hao. Do kaalam ane pero do hindi hao. You see, because they don't have wisdom. And wisdom comes from the Lord. So you can have all the knowledge that you have. But if you don't know how to use them, useless. God gave you your physical capital. Oh, that would be your time and that's your health. You see, if you don't take care of your health, God cannot use you. God can't use you. And then God gave you another capital, relational, your family. Your friends, your extended family in the missional community. You see that? God is so good. He gave us all of this. And he said, I want you to use it for the furtherance of my kingdom. But I want a return of my investment. But the biggest question is, how are you going to use this? First, we need to prioritize it. Let me show you the next slide. This is how the world, or some people, would prioritize God's capital. For them, number one is the financial. Regardless of what happens, financial would be number one. At the expense of shall we say, physical. At the expense of your health, you work so hard that it now has affected your health. You see that? Maybe number three is only intellectual. And number four is relational. You couldn't care less the relational. Regardless of what happens to the relationship, doesn't matter. As long as I get the number one. As long as I can get money, as long as I can get what I want, who cares about relational? And more so, spiritual. Who cares about going to church? Who cares about Bible study? Who cares about Miss You Day? As long as I have number one. And that is how the world looks at it. So how would God prioritize the capital that He gave you and me? Next slide. This is how God would want it. Number one should be the spiritual. Of course, the spiritual. That is why He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And number two, three, four, and five, you don't worry. I'll take care of that. But you see, for the world is, seek ye first the financial and I'll take care of the rest. That's not what the Lord said. That's why our lives are in a mess. So we interchange it. We don't do it in priority. And so the Lord is saying, I am giving you this capital, but someday I want to see the returns. Wow. But that would be another sermon. That would be about 3 or 4 weeks of series, okay? But the biggest misconception when it comes to money, especially when you talk about money from the pulpit, people start getting very uncomfortable. You know why? Because they think you are going to touch their money. In the first place, it is not your money. You know, there were several advices from old pastors before. There were two sides. One would say, you teach them how to use their money. Okay. The other one says, be careful. Don't talk about money on the pulpit. You know, they will not understand you. But through the years, if you've noticed me, I don't usually talk about money here. I just allow you to discover it and love the Lord, and the Lord will just take care of you. But you see, the point again is, if we are not going to teach people, you will be on the losing end. For example, if you don't know God's priority when it comes to His capital. Because sometimes our mind is this, every time we talk about money, which is the Lord's money, we think that we are being divested of our money. You need the word divest? Money taken away from you and never to return again? That's how you think about money. But you don't understand, when you read scriptures, Jesus is not talking about divesting you of the money that He gave you. Jesus wants you to reinvest the capital that He gave you so that you will be gaining more and you can use it for the furtherance of His kingdom. You see that? It's a different perspective. So we need to understand. So today we are going to see this in the right perspective. Romans 12:6. Everybody please read. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. Everybody gets something. There is no such thing as a no talent person. Everybody, at least you have one. You know, during the time when they talk about talent, it could be anything. And in your case, you have your talent, your skills, your abilities, your life experience, your temperament. Jesus has to make sure that you are unique from the others. You are special. So He has to give you certain abilities and qualities that only you have. Why? So that you can use it for His kingdom. Okay? Number three, accountability. God expects me to use them. Say it to me again. God expects me to use them. After a long time, the master of the servant came back and settled accounts with them. You see that? In the like manner that this master left and came back, in the same way Jesus left and he is coming back. And in the same manner that he wants to settle accounts, that master, Jesus is coming back to settle accounts with us. One day it will come. One day it will come. You and I are going to face Jesus eyeball to eyeball. Maybe I can see the color of his eyes, but I will hear those words, "What have you done with what I have given you?" I was thinking about this morning. It was a little bit, scary. Yucks. At the same time, you are anticipating his coming, full of joy. At the same time, the words of the scriptures is saying, it will come. In other words, the day of reckoning is coming. From the New King James Version, "After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them." That's what I like about this King James Version. And then you go to the Greek word study, and then it makes a totally different thing. The word reckon in Greek, it's a commercial term that means to compare accounts. It is a bookkeeping phrase that means to look at the records, then they study the facts, they compare the accounts, or settle the account. Just like a good CPA. He gets all the facts, he makes a report, and he makes sure these are the right facts so that he can make a good analysis, a cost-benefit analysis, whatever it takes, so that the boss can use it to make a decision. It is coming. And very significant that the Holy Spirit has to use the word reckon. Why? Because it tells us that the Lord Jesus is never satisfied with taking a shallow look at what we have done. What do I mean? You know, anad kita sa tawag nga palusot. Jesus will call you and he say, "What have you done? What have you done?" "Okay lang, Lord. Kamusta man? Okay lang, Lord. Okay na to. Okay. That will never happen. You think kapalusot kasi Ginoo? "Lord, okay lang to. That's okay. I am okay, man. Okay. I'm okay with my life." No. That will never happen. That's the word reckon. Jesus will not just simply accept your words on that day. Nope. He will not say, "Okay, you sure? Bring the records. Bring me the book." And he will search and he will dig and he wants to get the real picture. And then he will compare. Compare what? Compare what he wanted us to do and what we have done. That's the true meaning of reckon. That is why during their time, they understood this, that the master is coming and he is going to reconcile the records. "Did you do what I asked you to do?" "Okay, man, Lord, okay." No. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. "Wherefore we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all," say with me, "all, appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he has done, whether it be good or bad." I do not like to think about judgment. I do not like to see that day when I will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But it will come. It will come. And many people are saying that will not come. Well, read again the scriptures. You might be misinformed. Very clear. very clear. We will stand before the judgment seat of God. My prayer is that we have this understanding, because this will somehow change dramatically how we are going to live today. There is still time to change, because we will stand. Have you ever thought about this? Basi kapitsar ka, hindi na mag-abot. Hindi na mag-abot, ha? Maabot git. Ang balas tupad mo, maabot git. It will come, and we will answer how responsibly or irresponsibly we have lived our lives. No palusot whatsoever. And that's the reason why we should do our best to live every day for the glory of God. That is why we must make or redeem every moment that we can redeem today. Revelation 20. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And watch this. And books, with letter S, plural, were opened. There were several books. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. Praise the Lord. If your name is there, you will be in heaven. However, the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. In other words, aside from the book of life, which of course will be our salvation, but there is going to be another book will be opened to see what we have done. Heaven is free. Heaven is a gift. No question about that. No question about that. However, our rewards will be based on what we have done for the Lord. There's no question. We are all going to be there if you're saved, if you're born again. But the question is, what about rewards? In other words, someday there will be many surprises in heaven. What do I mean? Surprises, because you probably were expecting something in heaven for you, but by the time you get there, hey, why man? How come? May ari ni sayaw, ako wala. How come daw dako balaya de how akon to sa una, dako man to? Do I man to siya balay, dako man di balay? What? There will be many surprises in heaven as far as rewards is concerned. Why? Our choices will determine our rewards. So while you still can make the choice, let's make those choices. Hello? Amen? Are you still there? Number 4, utilization. It's wrong to bury what God gave me. But the man who had received 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. Oh, the first man took the money, doubled it. The second, the same thing. But the point of the story here is actually the third guy. What did he do? He buried it. Wow. Is there anything wrong when you bury those treasures? I mean, he did nothing. He did nothing. He just buried it. He wanted to play safe. He just wanted to play safe. But why was it that Jesus was so hard on him? Why? Next slide. He said, "You wicked, lazy servant, for doing nothing," he said, "you're lazy, you're wicked." What's the point? Lord Jesus, why were you so harsh on him? He did nothing. Mas mayo na lang na. Ngagintago, yeah. He did not take the risk. Not in God's equation. The point is this. We cannot please God by playing safe. We cannot play safe. We must take the risk. And if we don't, he said, wicked and lazy servant. Ooh. Meaning, doing nothing is inexcusable. Masipasiling ka, okay lang pa. Until mapatay ako, I will just do nothing. Mapabaya lang ko di. Maparumatay bala kung si Longo pa. You know, Jesus would rather that you take the risk and fail and try again than do nothing. Wow. Wow. So we have to try to make our life count. We have to make our lives make an impact. The Lord gave us all of this for nothing? No, you don't understand. God gave you almost everything to be who you are. He gave you the Holy Spirit. It was a precious thing that He gave you. So He doesn't want you to be a spectator in life. He wants you to be a participant in this life. And He will always be there for you. One thing is this. If you want to be a spectator in this journey, at this point, you have lost the joy and sparkle of your life. It is when we give our lives, what does the Lord say? It is more blessed to give than to receive. It is in the giving of your life. It is in the giving of the resources that you receive joy. It is in getting and getting and getting that you lose the meaning of life. Because life is not about you. Life is about the Lord Jesus, who invested His life in you, and He wants you to reinvest it again back to Him so that you can find meaning and purpose in life again. Don't lose the sparkle in your life. Be involved in His kingdom. Amen. Therefore, it is flat out wrong to waste your life. Don't waste your life. Don't waste your life again. As your friend, as your pastor, I urge you, I beseech you to seriously consider preparing for this day of reckoning. Why? Whether you like it or not, maabot gini siya. I am going to pray that you will have sleepless nights thinking about this. You'll never know. You won't wake up tomorrow. And you wasted your life. And how are you going to face the one who invested in you? He gave you everything. He died for you. He gave you the Holy Spirit. So He said, I cannot stand people who waste their lives. Number 6, motivation. Fear keeps me from developing my talent. Silingya, I was afraid and went out and hid your talent. Oh. Nadlok siya, he wanted to play safe. And so he was playing Satan's favorite tactic. Fear. And there are 3 kinds of fear. Number 1, self-doubt. Number 2, self-pity. Number 3, self-consciousness. Wow. Self-doubt. I can do it. I cannot do it. I'm not qualified. I don't have it. It's the fear of failure. Maybe you failed in the past. You don't want to fail again, so you don't want to have anything to do again with the Lord. Wrong. He is the God of the second chance. Number 2, self-pity. Like I said, you failed many times and then I don't know what happened to you, but you don't want it again. And there are 2 ways to respond to failure. Like Judas, remorse. He hung himself. Peter, remember, he repented and after 50 days of denying the Lord, he was back again. It doesn't matter where we have been. Tanan kita, fail. The most important thing is where we are moving ahead. It's the direction. And number 3, siling nila amuning sala sa taga Negros. Umot kong taga Bacolod lang. They are too self-conscious. Tuod na hindi. Tuod gali. Ay, tuod mong galing Bible, no? You know, galakat ka lang sa SM. Ang ginapinsan mo, gina-GPS ka na sa bilog kalibutan.
Everybody's watching you. You know? Is that, you are just walking and at the back of your mind, everyone is watching me. So, why? Why are we so self-conscious? It's pride. Nothing more. Who are you that the whole world would want to watch you? It's not. They don't. It's you. Imu-imu lang na. So when you have this, you don't want to be involved. What if I fail? Ano yung siling nila? Ano yung hambal nila? Ano yung marites nila sa akin? Ay, wala na. That is why you don't want to be a part of God's kingdom. Fear causes me to make excuses for doing nothing. Verse 24. Then the man, watch this, who had received one talent came and said, Master, I knew you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered. You know what he was doing? He was making all kinds of excuses. Just like many people. Tanan na lang excuse. You face the Lord someday. And number six, application. If I don't use it, what? I lose it. That's a principle that is true to anything in life. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. Lord, that is not fair. God has the right to take away what he gave you. And the reason why you lose it, because God is going to take it. If you don't use your muscles, you will lose your muscles. If you don't use your mind, you will lose your mind. If you don't use the opportunities that God will give you, you will lose it, whatever. You know why you will lose it? Because God is going to take it away from you. Why would God give it to you when you don't want to use it, when you don't want to reinvest everything that he gave you? He will take it away and give it to somebody else who knows how to reinvest everything that he has given. So don't be surprised if you're beginning to lose the sparkle and life in your life because you're not using it. You're not using it. And number seven, compensation. If I use my talents, I'm going to be rewarded. Oh, you love that? Oh, yes, we love that. Well done, good and faithful servant. Ang nabalaan nyo lang gid yang well done diri ang steak. But I hope mamati ka man sang well done pila ka adlaw. Well done, basi may hakus pa na. Oh, hindi niya. Lazy and wicked servant. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with few things. It doesn't have to be big. A few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. You know, this promotion over here someday in the new earth, some of you will be given bigger responsibilities when Jesus reigns for 1,000 years here. Aye, that will come. So three things that God promises: affirmation, promotion, and of course, celebration. Come and share your master's happiness. Wow. Hello? Are you still there? Now, before we continue, I'm going to call Shaney. You know, we have been talking about Missio Day, and this family, Brother Ray and Sister Elisa, is very much involved in the family on missions. And they do things now as a family. And I want you to hear din siya. Shaney, are you here? Oh, there. Sorry. Eh, kitako na si Imo eh. So, nakagamay pa. Naglala. Wow. Hey, microphone. Can I have a microphone here? Iblaga kanta ka di Sona. Kanta kong gapon. Dito ka gamay man to si mo Sona. Can I have a microphone? But you see, this family, this 7:30, si Daddy ya kag si Mommy ya, naghatag man testimony. and how they were able to form ang ilang missional community. They were one of the first who did it. And they are now reaping the benefits of being a part of this. Ay, ganay lang. Do wais lagan na maghatag microphone daw. Hello? Nobody's here? Imo command, imo do. Komando. Okay. Okay, all right, here we go. Number three. All right. Okay. Wala. Wala abot nga hindi. Pwede pa mag-andar. There you go. Number three. There you go. Sige dai. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I am Shani Despojo, daughter of Ray and Aliza Despojo from Mandalagan Missional Community. Technically, I grew up in a Christian family and participated in various church ministries, not only out of genuine love for service, but also because I felt obligated to conform to the expectations of a child raised in the church. However, everything changed when I became part of the missional community. It opened my eyes to a whole new way of understanding and living out my faith as a Christian. If you were to ask me what I love the most about being part of the missional community, I would say it's the emphasis on modeling, authenticity, and family. In our community, we have people from different age groups, including kids, teenagers, young professionals, and adults. This means that we don't segregate the young from the old, but instead provide opportunities for everyone to learn from one another. When issues or conflicts arise, we observe how the adults handle them, because we resolve things as a family. In my previous experience with small groups, I noticed that while they imparted various knowledge, there was a lack of life-to-life application. It felt more like a transaction rather than a genuine relationship. However, in the missional community, I have no fear of missing out because I know that others will continue to share and take responsibility. It's not about being self-righteous. It's about modeling and supporting one another without the need for fear or judgment. Being part of the missional community has allowed me to be more open about what I'm going through. I've learned to be genuine and authentic with my emotions because I found a safe space where I can be myself without any pretense. Lastly, I am thankful to the Lord for the missional community as it has brought my family closer and provided us with precious moments that I'll surely cherish. Within this community, we have the privilege to worship and serve the Lord, which has truly deepened our bond and strengthened our faith. It's not just about our immediate family, but we also have an extended family within the MC who shares the same goals and aspirations. We walk hand in hand, lifting each other up and embarking on this incredible journey of faith together. To God be the glory.
Thank you. Thank you, Dai. Dali lang, Inang, ikaw na, eh. But, you see, this family, could you please stand, Brother Ray, Sister Aliza, there you go. Ilang mo na yung mga parents. These people are also very busy. See, Brother Ray is Mr. Globe. If you need anything sa Globe, he's the man. Sa technical, okay? Sorry, ah. But it only shows how busy they are. Very, very busy. But they can still afford to form this family on missions. It's not something abugat, correct? It is something ginalantaw mo lang every day what is happening. I hear the word modeling. You know, though ginamodel lang ni papa mo, mama mo, and you're just trying to follow. Nakabalo ko na kung ano sila mag-away. Kung ano man nila isolve problema nila, no? It's right there, okay? So in other words, and then she also mentioned that aside from the family that you have, may mga extended family na kamo, mga neighbors nyo. So that's how it is, no? So it's something that you do on a natural level. Hindi hard sell of the gospel. It's modeling, life modeling in your neighborhood. And ang munang nakita mo, baka namig it. Thank you very much. Salamat. Let's give her a big, big hand. Thank you. Thank you. Sige. Thank you, Gid. I know for some of you, hindi pag hindi clear missional community, it's okay. It's okay. Give yourself time. Give yourself time. It's not easy to see these things, these new things happening in our midst. But the point now is, what are we going to do? One, we must redeem the time. Okay? Sabihin ni Paul, we must redeem the time because the days are evil. You know, the common denominator between a rich man and a poor man is that both of them, they only have 24 hours a day to live. What they do with those time makes the difference. Make the difference. And for all of us, I understand, and we have lost all kinds of time in the past. And we need to redeem them. Siling nila, when time is lost, you cannot redeem it. Di ba? Money can be replaced, but time cannot. Is that it? True. But you know, Paul is saying you can redeem the time because the days are evil. What he means is that when you redeem, whatever time is left for you and me, if we are going to be careful in the stewardship of our time, we can still redeem those times. We can still. I mean, all of us, we are now living in the age of destruction, but we have to be conscious about all of this so that we can still redeem the time. In other words, we have to know how to balance our time today. We have to know how to prioritize our time today, or else we are going to lose our children. You can imagine the one that's being sent by my daughter from Australia. Oh, that children in some schools are now being given the right to decide who they are. If they want to be an animal, they can be an animal. Oh, a teacher cannot do anything. If the child says, I'm a cat, the teacher will say, meow. You can, you know, these crazy things are beginning to happen. So the more reason that we should keep our families today, or else we are going to lose them. So again, the Apostle Paul, Colossians 4:5 says this, Silingya, walk in wisdom toward them that are without, those who do not know the Lord, redeeming the time. The word here is kairos, opportunities. Whatever. The thing is, the Holy Spirit is saying, you do everything you can to make up for lost territory. In other words, you buy up all the time you can and make the most of every opportunity, whatever ang nabilin. Whatever. Let's not waste our time anymore. Let's not waste. So we have lost opportunities. Along the way, we squandered our opportunities. We neglected our family sometime, neglected our children. Whatever it is, whatever, lost opportunities, we can still redeem the time. Amen? Don't give up. Don't give up. Please, don't give up. I have met many parents during the 7:30 service, and they were just so honest to say, pwede pa gali? Pwede pa. Pwede pa. Don't lose hope. God is still the God of the second chance. We can still redeem the time. Amen? Therefore, the second thing we must do, we must repent. Not in a sense, repent nga mag-ibi-ibi. No. Change of mind. Remember, metanoia? Turn around. Do something. Let's do something about what we can. Acts chapter 17. At the times of ignorance, God winked at. But now, God commandeth all men everywhere to repent. This is the Apostle Paul. He was given a chance to share the gospel to these learned, educated people. And he was so bold, and he told them to repent. And then it says here, before, God was just overlooking the acts of people. Dugin na sirahan niya lang, mataya. But today, he is no longer winking at them. He is telling us boldly, every one of you, repent, change your mind. Let us all redeem the time. Amen? In other words, today, God no longer winks or overlooks our ignorance I don't want to use the word, but it's stupidity. Why? Because you know the truth and you still say no to God. Let's pray. Lord, these are hard times and you are knocking in every heart. Lord, we have lost opportunities. But Lord, we know that you have given each and everyone talents, abilities, giftings, whatever. And we pray, dear God, that you are going to just give us the grace to redeem the time that we lost. And so, Lord, thank you for what you are going to do. Lord, give us the grace now to accept our failures, our failings. Give us the grace to accept the lost opportunities of our lives. But give us also the grace to redeem the time. And thank you once again for who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.